The veteran's name is Charles Foreman. They were born on February 15th, 1949. They served in the Army branch, and they were part of the Vietnam War. They achieved the rank of E5, and we are recording this on November 7th, 2015. I am Lisa, and I'm conducting the interview, no relation. All right, so where exactly were you born?
Where?
Mm-hmm.
Coachville, Pennsylvania.
Okay. And where were your parents? Like, what did your parents do?
Mom was pretty well stayed at home. My dad was a painting contractor.
Okay. Do you have any siblings?
I got three sisters and two brothers.
Were they also?
One brother died about 2 years ago, and my sister died about 6 months ago.
Oh, I'm sorry
to hear
that.
And now there's four of us left.
Did any of them else serve in the Army?
The older sister served in the Air Force. She's still alive. She's 79.
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
Yeah.
So, let's see if I can get this right here. Okay. Do you remember when you got into the Army? Like, were you drafted, or were you...
I joined the Army in October 1967. Mm-hmm. I came out of high school the same year.
Okay. What was it like for enlisting, like, the training and the,
Yeah, 1967, nobody was doing anything because of the Vietnam War.
Mm-hmm.
But everywhere I went for a job, they would say, well, you're going to get drafted, you're going to get drafted. So I just went ahead and joined.
Okay. And what made you choose the Army?
Because the Navy wouldn't take me. Now, I tried to get in the Navy, and at the time, everybody was trying to get in the Navy Air Force.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and you took a test, and I was in a group that they had, they didn't need me.
Mm-hmm.
The middle group was, they could take the smart ones, the high test, or the low ones. But the middle one, which I was in, there was no opening. I just went and joined the Army.
Okay, what kind of test was it?
I get to qualify, see what you qualify for. Anything I could figure it out. Mm-hmm. And they called me up, told me no. I said, I could have done worse if you wanted me to. Could have gotten the lower group.
What was basic training like?
It wasn't too bad.
Do you have any drill sergeants that were memorable?
Any what?
Drill sergeants?
I remember my drill sergeant's name, and I took him to Fort Bragg for 67 and 68, because I went in the Army in October. First couple of days was rough because I'd never really been away from home before except Boy Scout camp.
Mm-hmm.
It was pretty close to Boy Scout camp, too. You know, a little discipline. A lot of guys worse off than me that were really homesick. I adjusted pretty fast, and basic wasn't too bad. I did pretty good in basic. I was in pretty good shape back then.
Okay.
Because I was 18 years old, too.
Did you have any specialized training?
Nah, my AITs were... started out in some kind of computer school, but I didn't last long in there. So I went to Fort Bragg, and they sent me to school to be a mechanic.
Okay.
Which I graduated from then. Went to Germany from there.
All right. And so you said it was a little bit hard to adapt to the military life at first?
Yeah, just first couple of weeks.
First couple of weeks, okay.
I joined. I couldn't really complain like somebody got drafted. They were really crying the blues. So I joined. I just accepted it and went about my business.
Okay. And where exactly did you serve then during the Vietnam War?
Where?
Mm-hmm.
Benoit.
Okay. And what did you do there?
Yeah, when I first got there, they put me in artillery out in the jungle.
Mm-hmm.
And I had no artillery experience at all. You know how the Army is. You know how the Army is. So I got there and reported to the captain. We're out in the jungle. They flew out. There's only one way in or out because there's a base out there. And there's no roads or anything. Just fly. Everything in Vietnam, you flew around.
Mm-hmm.
And I went into the captain. Like I said, I was already an E5. He said, what do you know about the guns? I said, they go boom. And he looked at me and said, you're not artillery? I said, no. He said, I've only been in the Army. I said, a little over 2 years. He said, what did you do? I said, I was in Germany. He said, no, that explains it. I said, well, I was a mechanic. I was a mechanic for the first year in Germany. Then they had an opening in an office making dog tags and ID cards, which I went and took the test and didn't qualify. I knew the captain, and I told her, you give me a chance at this job, and I can do it. Because my buddy, it's easy. You just ID cards, you took the pictures, made the ID cards, and made the dog tags.
Mm-hmm.
And I got, you know, I did the job and did a good job. So I did that. As far as I got the nom, my two MOSs, for the first 2 or 3 months, I just kind of helped out with the different groups. Helped carry ammo, get stuff set up, and received the food, and kept care of the beer and the sodas. And somebody had to do it. And I didn't care what I did. I was there for a year, man. I did whatever you wanted me to do, I did.
Okay.
Then I got shipped back to the rear after about 4 months. And I was motor pool sergeant for the last, I wasn't qualified out either, but I did a good job. I got a couple letters that said I did a good job.
Okay. So I take it you saw a lot of fighting then?
Nah. We did a lot of shooting.
Mm-hmm.
What we did, being in artillery, being in artillery, we had three big guns, 105s, and they could shoot 7 miles. And what the infantry was out there walking around doing, actually, what I call the fighting. I mean, there's no place safe.
Mm-hmm.
We had guns and everything. We got hit a couple times, but nothing bad. And what we do is we shoot artillery for them. They call in, we would shoot the artillery. That was pretty safe, but like I said, there's no place safe. Even back in the rear, the last 6 months, it was, you know, you never know what's going to happen. But nothing happened back in the rear.
Okay.
Out in the field, not a whole lot happened either. We got hit once or twice, but nothing to write home about. My buddy got hit with some shrapnel for mortar, but other than that, you know, it wasn't real, real bad.
Okay. Did you form any friendships over there?
Yeah, but I was back, not out in the field so much, but I was back to the rear. And motor pool sergeant, I had about 5 guys working under me. And, you know, we just sit around, you know, once you got back to the rear, it was almost like a 8-to-5 job. We went to motor pool in the morning, got everything set up, set the drivers out to take the ammo out to the field to fly out to the other people. And worked on the trucks, and 5 o'clock, we knocked off for dinner and played a little football. Sat around, drank beer, and just had a good time. And the part about the drugs, that wasn't true. There's people on drugs, but all the people I knew, we never did any kind of drugs. But we drank a lot of beer, but we never did no drugs.
Okay. Have you stayed in touch with them at all?
No.
No?
No. Not a one. In Germany, I was real close to a bunch of guys over there, but never got in touch with them either. Think about it sometimes, but, you know, how you find them. A lot of them were older than me. I was younger than the German, well, I guess, you know. Probably, most of them were probably going. The Vietnam ones, like I said, first couple months out in the field with the artillery, I didn't get to know any of them guys. I was kind of bouncing around between doing little stuff, you know, getting ammo lined up and handed to them during a firefight. And didn't get to know them too good. They pretty well stayed themselves. And I got back to the rear, and the 5 mechanics I had, or, you know, we just kind of right about our business.
Okay. Did you keep in contact with your family while you were over there?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Of course, back in, you just had letters. You didn't have videos and phones and computers. You wrote. Yeah, we wrote. My mother and father and my girlfriend were supposed to wait for me. She didn't wait, anyway.
I'm sorry.
No. I knew she was. She's still in high school. She's going to sit there for 3 years and wait for me? I don't think so. I didn't wait either.
Okay. Did you get any care packages from your family while you were over there?
Yeah.
Yeah?
My mom used to send me our hometown paper.
Okay.
Every week she'd wrap them up and send them over to me. And I've been waiting a couple of girls when I was over there. They send me cookies, and Christmas time send me funny little things. And yeah. I had a good relationship.
That's nice. So besides playing football and drinking, what else did you do on your takes off?
In Vietnam? There wasn't a whole lot to do. I took an in-country R&R up around Da Nang. You know, you got steak, and they treated you good. It was fun, but, like I said, you got up in the morning, you went to work, and got off 5 o'clock, took a shower, went and had dinner and at the mess hall. And funny story about that, the mess hall, we had roast beef a lot. It was tasty, but it had a rainbow tint to it. And it was so bad. I mean, not so bad. It was good. We ate it. the dogs were hanging around it, and you walk out and throw a piece of roast beef down, that dog will come and sniff it. He wouldn't eat it. Now, you think about a dog with a piece of roast beef, he gonna gobble it down. I don't know what was wrong. I'm still alive, but... Well, I'm serious. You put that roast beef... I'd be tired of it. Everybody, you know, we had it. It seemed like about three nights a week.
Mm-hmm.
But it was good. It was tasty.
Okay.
Beat the sea rations we had for the first 4 or 5 months. Out of cans and stuff. Mm-hmm. Back in.
Was it easy to get, like, supplies while you were with the artillery groups?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Okay. I mean, supplies for us, for mm-hmm. ourselves, for like, what we needed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We were supplied pretty good.
Okay. So, where were you when the war ended?
Still in Benoit.
Still in Benoit?
Benoit was our base. Well, the unit I was with left about 2 months, about a month and a half before I was eligible to go home. So it just kind of, I was in a fire station for about a month.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't do anything. Sit there waiting for a fire. We had dumpster fire one time, and that's about it.
Okay.
Just to finish my time out. They kept me the whole 2 years. I was in 2 years, 11 months and 19 days out of a 3-year tour.
Wow. So, how did you get back home? Was it through, like, a commercial airline, or was it, like, any special way?
Yeah, they flew commercial.
Commercial?
And when I came home, used to be when you left Vietnam, you came into California.
Mm-hmm.
And, you got discharged out of there, then you flew wherever you lived at. But about 2 months before I got out, they were flying to Fort Dix. Of course, I lived outside of Philadelphia.
Mm-hmm.
So I flew to Fort Dix. My parents were there and picked me up. So made it easier than trying to get another flight across the country. Because back then, I wasn't, you know, you want to make things easy as you could. Fly from point A to point B. Don't go to A to B to C. You know what I'm talking
about?
Yeah.
Okay, so how was the reception from your family and by the community when you came back?
Pretty well just the family.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the community, you know, we were small. I lived in a small town in Pennsylvania. Everybody's glad to see me, all my friends and the postmaster and the people who owned the stores and stuff. It was good. It was real good.
Okay. How was it to adjust to the civilian life?
I had no trouble. I came home... I turned 21. I went to Vietnam January 17th, and February 50th I turned 21. So I turned 21 in Vietnam. And when I came home, I was almost 22. And, my dad was a painting contractor, and I worked for him a little bit. After I took a couple of weeks off, then I went to a job in a hardware company driving trucks. Worked there 28 years. They closed up in 99, and I worked for another company for another 16, so I only had 2 jobs in 44 years. That's not bad.
Mm-mm.
Been working 50.
Wow. So how did the wartime experience affect your life at all?
The what? The war experience affect my life?
Mm-hmm.
It's funny. I think more and more now, like with the hat and the shirts and stuff, which I never did for probably 30 years. Now it's all starting to sink in. Plus, I got Agent Orange. You know what that is?
Mm-mm.
You don't?
I remember vaguely hearing about it, but don't get taught too much about that stuff.
When I was 60, which was 6 years ago, I was diagnosed with Agent Orange. That's a disease you get when they spray the jungles that kill the vegetation.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it affects a lot of people. When I first got diagnosed, when I was 60, they said I wouldn't work again because my sugar's so high and all kinds of stuff. I said, well, I can't stop working at 60 years old. I got to keep working. So I lost 30 pounds and got on a treatment program, and now my sugar is as low as anybody else's now. My sugar, if you know anything about it, my sugar was like 98 this morning. They don't want to go to 140. And I only take one pill at night, one pill in the morning. So I got really under control. And except for having Agent Orange, and it could lead to other things later on down the road, but I don't worry about it.
Mm-hmm.
I'll cross that bridge when I come to it. It might not ever bother me again. But some people use it for a crutch. A lot of Vietnam veterans use the war for a crutch. And I don't think the system's fair. I got Agent Orange, which is a disease, which I will always have. And they got me 20%. I get like $300 a month. I talked to a guy the other day, he's 22. He hurt his knee in Iraq. He gets $1,600 a month. Think about that. I mean, I'm not mad. I'm just, the system sucks. Somebody gonna listen to this tape?
Yes. Oh, yeah. Yeah, we'll edit it and things like that, so.
What?
No, I'm just thinking about my dad. He got hurt too.
Oh, he did?
Not severely. He's just got metal rods in his legs and stuff like that.
Not severely.
Yeah.
In the war?
No. This was way back before the war. But I'm just thinking about how he's got sleep apnea too and things like that. And he only gets so much percentage from the Army too. So.
Well, I'm going for more. I think I'm almost not eligible for more. Mm-hmm. Before it leads to something more serious. In fact, Monday I'm going to VA and look into it. You know, I talked to guys that I said it hurt 89%, and they're no worse off of me. So am I eligible for more or not? You know, sleeping, I have no trouble sleeping.
Mm-hmm.
I sleep in the truck two nights a week, and I sleep in my bed two or three nights a week. No, I have no trouble sleeping.
What made you decide to do truck driving?
When I went to work for the first company, when I came out of the Army, I had no intention of ever driving a truck. It never even crossed my mind. But they asked me one day if I wanted to be a truck driver. I said, I don't know. He said, well, we'll train you right here in the yard. We won't send you, back then they train you at your company, like Benora would train Benora drivers. Mm-hmm. They don't do that no more, but anyway. I said, okay, but don't push me. All the time you want. So I'm out there, drove around the parking lot and black trailers in and out, and took a couple of trips with other drivers. I drove and they just watched and became a driver. And then about 2 years after that, I got transferred here to South Carolina. Get out of that Northeast. Yeah, Northeast ain't no good. Too complicated. New York, Philadelphia, and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been doing it ever since.
Okay. Did you learn any life lessons while you were in the military?
I think it gave me better work ethic, in the Army you don't call in sick. You know, when I was somewhere and I go to work and my shirt's in, your gig line, the gig line, everything lines up. People recognize that. I had an old boss one time a couple years ago, and he said, you're in the Army, aren't you? No, you're in the service. I did. I know. Is your shirt's always tucked in and your buckle's always lined up with your... I think it makes you a better person, I believe. No. Can't swear to it, but it sounds good. I always work good. Even if I went in the Army, I still think I would have... Might not have become a truck driver, because you don't know what's going to happen in 3 years. 2 years in Germany, a year in Vietnam... I might have went to work somewhere in Pennsylvania and still be working there.
Mm-hmm.
Mill or something like that. But everything has a... I don't know what you call it. Now, look, I got no idea. What are you going to do when you grow up? You know what I mean?
I'm almost on my last year of college and I still don't know what I'm doing.
Yeah, well, I came home... Like I said, I came home to Vietnam 20. 21, so it's about 22, and somebody told me I'd be driving a tractor and trailer by the time I was 23. You're crazy. I love it. I'm still doing it. I'll be 67. I get my full Social Security, because I done passed that age. I take my full Social Security. And the other company had a good pension for me, which, I ain't touched it yet either, so I could quit working. I like working. I like to irritate the supervisors I got. You think I'm kidding? Ask your dad.
No, I see how busy he is when he's got the work call weekends. So.
Oh, is he got call week? Okay, I understand.
Yeah.
But that's their fault. I can straighten that out.
Were there any other stories you wanted to tell us?
Yeah, the only funny story I tell everybody is. Because I went in the Army in 67, graduated in 67, and went to Germany, became an E-5, came home on leave to go to Vietnam, and I wasn't old enough to drink a beer in Pennsylvania. I always thought that's a good story. Well, think about it.
Well, yeah,
I was in the Army 2 years and 2 months. I was an E5 sergeant. Came home to go to Vietnam and wasn't allowed to drink a beer. I mean, it's a stupid thing, but it always bugged me. I mean, I did back in them days, you know. But it just...
It wasn't legal.
It wasn't legal, right.
Well, the drinking age in Germany is also lower than here, so...
Yeah, oh, yeah, a lot of beer in Germany. That's all they do. Well, you said, what did I do in Vietnam besides work, get a shower, eat, four rounds of football? We had like 300 teams, just a little playing, you know. Germany, you got up in the morning, you went to work, came home, took a shower, you got your civilian clothes on, and you went to the clubs. What's the difference? Just like now. Mm-hmm. It's like real life. Now, Germany was good duty back in. I don't know how they do it now, but back in they liked us.
I'd still say they fairly like us over there. Yeah, depending on what base you go to. Yeah.
But right now they're getting all these refugees and stuff over there. I guess they're having a heck of a time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, heard on the news that they were trying to limit now how many refugees they're taking because they're getting too many.
No, it's just like our own country. My neighbor's a Mexican. He's been here for 15 years. He married to America. They got two kids. They call me Pop-Pop, and I love him. But, you know, they're protesting now. They don't want him on Saturday Night Live. Do you see that on television?
Mm-mm.
Donald Trump.
Oh, mm-hmm.
They don't want him on Saturday Night Live. All these little groups, they just take two people to protest and shut everything down. You know, it makes me mad. You know what I'm talking about?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And it's not right.
Yeah.
You know, it's still America. I don't know what my granddaughter is going to be if she grows up. But, you get used to what you're, you know. She'll be okay in it. It's like, you know, you will the next 40 or 50 years. You adjust. What I'm looking at when I was back in the 60s compared to what today is. I still got a flip phone. I don't know how to use a computer. I have no idea. I don't have a computer. I don't have email. People call me up and say, hey, what's your email address? I ain't got one. You have an email address? No. I still write checks for all my bills. My daughter-in-law laughs at me. She says, someday it's going to stop. I don't know, probably not for a while. Even the computers in our truck, everything's in there. I can log on to duty, and that's about it. I can log off duty. But some people down there, my 7-year-old daughter, granddaughter is a whiz. My 15-year-old grandson, anything happens, people call him for advice how to set something up. But they grew up with it.
Mm-hmm. You know? Yeah, that's the same in my family. I'm the one that they come to when there's computer problems. Oh,
yeah? Well, your dad's pretty good on a computer for some reason. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, if he doesn't figure it out, I'm usually the one to figure it out. So
I found that out by... I need testing, but I was trying to find something out. And they sent me from one supervisor, another supervisor, another supervisor. Finally, I called Michigan, Gary, Michigan, which is our headquarters.
Mm-hmm.
Talked to a girl up there. She knows me. And she said, I'll check. Well, I came back and your dad was sitting in the office about 3 days later. I said, what's the matter? I said, I tried to find out what my raises do. They sent me to four different people. He went, September. And yeah, I know it. I just wanted to confirm it.
Mm-hmm.
I said, why couldn't them other people do that? So he's pretty good on the computer.
Mm-hmm.
Knows the stuff. I don't know nothing about computers. I don't need to know.
Yeah, he had to use a lot of the computers for his last few years in the military and stuff like that.
No, he did?
So, yeah, he usually has a desk job, so. Yeah.
Such is life.
Pretty much. He'd rather go out and do construction, but.
He would.
Yeah.
Well, that office job I had in Germany, you know, I think I did about 9 or 10 months before I got orders in Vietnam, but. I'd drive a truck, you know, like I said, I'll be 67 in about 2 months. And I do 4 days a week. I do 2,100 miles a week. That's all I want. pays good. We're decent, we're very lucky. I can make more. I don't want to make more. I don't understand. They'll call me up, want me to go somewhere. I ain't going. Mad at me. But I'm going to keep on going. My brother-in-law, 72, he drives truck. He still drives part-time for AutoZone. He's 72 years old.
It's very commendable.
Well, he likes, they got about 60, 70 acres down around Star, down around Hartwell, you know where that is?
Mm-hmm.
And he just says after about 2-3 days at home, I'm ready to go do something. So he does.
Okay.
What else you got there, Keith?
Let's see. Well, we still got 4 minutes, so any
four
other
stories? 4 minutes?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they have to be...
Oh, it has to be half an hour.
Yeah, uh-huh. Any other stories?
I guess. I came home, I was, your house, I had three houses and two wives between 20 and 25 years old. Had nothing to do with this, but it's funny. About 21 years ago, my second wife left me.
Mm-hmm.
And bought the house. And I lived by myself 25 years in a mobile home. I always tell people I did everything backwards. I started out, most people started out mobile home, go to houses. I started with houses and went to mobile home. But my ex-wife bought me out, so. And I'm happy, and I paid cash for 93, and I got two bedrooms, two bathrooms, nice yard. My boy lives next door, I own it too. You don't pay rent. Don't rent to your kids. They don't pay rent. But other than that, good life. Can't complain. Military was good. Both companies I worked for have been good. And I've been a pain to most of them. Especially this new company. The work company. Nah, I just... Yeah, when you saw me so long, I've been through more supervisors and dispatchers constantly. I don't get their names sometimes that they're gone. And I just keep hanging around. They tried to fire me twice. And I'm still there. They don't want to know all this, do they?
Oh, hey. It's your tape.
Oh, that was supposed to be? Okay. Somebody's going to look at this.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I don't get a copy of it, do I?
Do you want a copy?
What do you want, a DVD?
Yeah, it would be on a DVD.
Yeah, if you do. No big deal.
Okay, I'll see.
I can laugh at myself.
It'll definitely be up on the our Google Drive, and I can see about getting you a copy of it.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know, like you said, what you talked about, I heard something the other day about people doing stuff like that going into the Congress for the rest of the year. If somebody wants to go look through it, they can go through it anytime they want.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
I don't know where I heard of that, though.
The American Legion actually does that too. They've got a lot of World War I and World War II veterans that do it. So they have all those the tapes, I mean.
Oh, okay, because there can't be no more World War I veterans. Because they would have been born in 1900. Because
mm-hmm.
that was at 1918, right?
Like 1914 to 1918, yeah, I think so.
Yeah, somewhere, okay.
Yeah.
Like Vietnam was 1975. I mean, 1959 to 75. We just, after 15,000 people were killed, we just got up and left. Stupid. Now you got me there. You got me started. But think about it. There were 15,000 killed. Did you know that? Okay, 15,000 killed. We just probably had a war run, one, and they pulled out. So what was the use of it? Communists came right into Saigon the next day and called it Ho Chi Minh City. So much for war. Now look at the last one, Iraq. We just pulled out of there too. Why get involved? They dropped one big bomb. Your dad probably said.
No, I don't think he's ever said that before. Nah. But he's questioned why we've had to go over there.
Yeah. They just keep putting their nose in the places they don't need to be. Both sides. Republican, Democrat. I'm Republican, by the way.
It's all right. So are my parents.
Huh?
So are my parents.
Are they Republican?
Yeah.
Most military people are.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah, they tend to be a little nicer to the military than the Democrats do.
I don't know. They gotta do something.
Well, that's about it. If you don't have anything else to say.
No? I'm done.
All right. Thank you so very much.
No problem.